Nice, thank you. Good morning. Grace to you, peace to you, welcome to you. I hope you had a good Thanksgiving. How many of you ate something different other than turkey? Oh, good, quite a few. Okay, all right. Okay, now I'm curious. What'd you have?
Skewers, steak and chicken.
Steak and chicken skewers. Okay, all right. Yes, what'd you have? Armenian feast. Wow. All right. I'm coming to your house next year. All right. Hot dogs. Okay. All right. Well, grace to you, peace to you, welcome to you. I call your attention to announcements. You can take a look at what's going on there in the Nuggets. A lot of different things going on. I won't repeat them except to say that next Sunday we're having a potluck, and maybe there'll be skewers with meat on them, I don't know, but we'll be having a potluck, and also next Sunday, I believe the choir is busting it out next Sunday. Hello? Is the choir busting it out next Sunday? Okay, thank you. Okay. So anyway, let's take a deep breath. At least I think I need to. And again, please lift up the work of our church, the leadership of our church, all these things in prayer. And Karen has an announcement. Yes, thank you, Karen, for reminding me.
No.
I think it's going to be one of those Sundays. Okay.
Good morning, everybody. Ken talked about next Sunday. I'm here to tell you two things that are happening in 2 weeks. So on December 9th, two things in two weeks. The first thing is after worship in coffee chat, I'm going to just gather people who are interested in helping with hosting, marketing, or registration for our Whole Lives training for February. So if you're interested in cooking for some hungry sexuality educators, or sending out emails or anything like that, find me in coffee chat next week, because our training is in February, and that sounds like a long time, but it's really not. So that'll be next two Sundays from now in coffee chat. The evening of the 9th, Joyce Schneider and I are putting together a service that we're calling Advent Calming, and it'll be right here on the chancel. And a time to quiet. So it doesn't have to, it won't be a sparkly, loud service. It'll be a really quiet, calm service. And sometimes we need that. So in the midst of Advent, you can take a pause, 6 o'clock in the evening on the 9th, right here on the chancel, and it's going to be a great service. Okay, thanks.
All right, thank you. Right. Now, okay. Again, I invite you to take a deep breath. We allow this moment to center ourselves. I hope that somewhere, somehow, the Spirit of life and love moves within you and drives home deep within you the conviction that you are loved, that you are of great value, and that you are welcome here. And no matter who you are or where you are on life's journey, you are welcome here. Sue, please call us to worship.
Good morning. If you would please join me in the call to worship. With faith to face our challenges,
with love that casts out fear,
with hope to trust tomorrow,
we accept this day as the gift it is, a reason for rejoicing.
So, with gratitude, let us celebrate the richness and diversity of life. Please stand if you are comfortably able, and let us sing.
Wondrous things past all.
Thank you for this time when we get to pray together. Let us pray. And so, Spirit of life and love, we are looking for some moment of quiet and thanks and gratitude and even quiet joy. We allow this parade of thoughts to go through our head. It may include a pumpkin pie and a relative, or perhaps a football game, or maybe the need of our neighbor. We ask ourselves the question, have they started the Christmas music too soon? All of these things, in the busyness of our lives, in the busyness of our minds, in the crowded places of our hearts, we look for sanctuary and refuge. Help us to find it in each other. Find it here in this place, in this time. Help us to find it in you. For you are here for us. And for your presence. And for your gifts of peace. We give thanks. Amen. Good morning. Over the last 2 weeks, I've encouraged us to have a comprehensive view of life. A comprehensive view of life, which means embracing the parts of life that we usually want to avoid. Not only do we want to avoid pain and grief, but we want our institutions to protect us from pain and from grief. We want our churches to be happy clappy. And yet to be happy clappy all the time is not only impossible, it is disingenuous. So, as we try to grow and mature in our spirits, we embrace the full bag of life and all that it offers. And despite all that, in the face of the way life is, we celebrate the deep goodness of life. And this is why life is not always fun, but it is always pregnant with joy. Well, our service today is kind of like Macy's Thanksgiving Day Parade. We begin in the spirit of giving thanks, and we will end with a Christmas carol. We start with the turkey and end with Santa Claus. We are being liturgically inappropriate. Church liturgy purists are turning over in their graves at this very moment. Are turning over in their gravy. You remember the joke from last week. See, you all do listen. Okay. Thanksgiving is a secular state-declared holiday, and technically Christmas doesn't begin until December 25th. Yet, here we are. We're doing both and probably not doing either one justice. But this is where our hearts and our minds are. You saw the cover of the bulletin? Did you look at it close? You didn't? Take a look. It is inappropriate. We may still be munching on leftover turkey in our sandwiches while we are online ordering Christmas gifts for our grandkids. But it could be worse. This is better than munching on our grandkids and ordering presents for a bunch of turkeys. And I bet before the season's out, you will be ordering presents for a bunch of turkeys. It certainly can feel that way sometimes. But which came first? How did we get to this place? The mashup of the holidays in our culture are the train wreck of ho, ho, ho and cranberries in our own minds. Oh my God, the humanity. This reminds me of a joke. Why did the cranberries turn red? I'm waiting for the ushers to say, I don't know, Pastor Ken, why did the cranberries turn red? That's usually what they do. Thank you. Because they saw the turkey dressing. I know, again, oh my God, the humanity. Make Pastor Ken stop. Separating ourselves from the culture, that is, to be in the world but not of the world, is a demanding ask, especially this time of year. While our time together this morning may reflect the culture too much, I hope our experience of our time together is closer to what it means to be the people of God, and that is an experience of joy. Let me try to tie all this up into a neat package with a pretty bow. This Sunday, today, in church liturgical year circles, is known as Christ the King Sunday. This is the last Sunday of the church year. In the course of a church year, we go through a different holy days and liturgical colors such as purple and white and red and blue and gold and green. And as people of God defined but not confined by a particular faith tradition, we began the church year last Advent. We began by being in solidarity with all suffering people for all time, waiting and preparing in hope for a better life for all people. We celebrated the realization of that hope, the realization of the truth that in a vulnerable human baby, the powerless love of God overcomes the loveless power of the world. And then the church year encourages us to celebrate that the secrets that make life most meaningful are no longer hidden but revealed to us. These truths are not so hard, but when revealed to us, they are a true epiphany. The truth and power of love and the true nature of life and love is given a name and it's given a face. And we take time between Christmas and Easter to explore what happens when a real person tries to live a life of love in a fear-filled world. It cost him dearly. And yet, it was worth the love. This unfolds in the months between Christmas and Easter. It's a relatively short season. The longest season of the church year is the time between Easter and today. Today, which is the last Sunday of the church year. These are the months dedicated to prayer and to study, as our covenant says. Prayer and study of the word about life, individually and corporately. We join generations of believers trying to figure out how to live and love faithfully and joyfully. It is a spiritual roller coaster with its ups and downs. It is a sleigh ride that has its moments of gliding across the beautiful frozen landscape of the world. It is a spiritual train wreck. Yes, we are a spiritual train wreck. A spiritual train wreck of Christ and culture. You see, there's a lot in this package of the church year. A lot. There's a lot in this gift of spirituality as we pray and we study and we explore. What is the meaning of the life of Jesus? His death, his resurrection, his ongoing spirit in the lives of his community of believers and followers. And what does it mean for us to respond faithfully to every challenge that God brings into our lives and brings to the doorstep of this church? Sometimes it's a roller coaster. Sometimes it's a sleigh ride. Sometimes it's a train wreck. But it's all grace. And you see, today, the last Sunday of the church year, is the bow on top. No matter how many ups and downs, no matter how many curveballs that life throws at us, no matter how many train wrecks we are in, the life, the spirit, the love, and the vision of Jesus, of a loving God, and the goodness of life reigns over all the roller coasters, all of the sleigh rides, all of the train wrecks of the world. Grace, love, hope, faith, courage, justice, peace. These are the last words because Jesus is King. And so, we follow ancient traditions that remind us to look not to the past, really. I mean, we explore tradition and we look at this person's life that lived a long time ago and all of that. But our hearts and our minds and our lives, individually and corporately, are intentionally pointed to the future. Now, we do some old, ancient things. And we'll be doing that today. But let me remind you, we hang green branches in the middle of winter to remind us not to look back, but to look forward to life-giving warmth of love in springtime. We light candles during the shortest days of the year, not to look back, but so that we may look forward to the longer days of light and sunshine and what it means to be a light ourselves in the world. We sing carols of hope, not so much because of nostalgia, but we do so with a defiant edge to our voices because looking always toward the future, we know God's love, peace, and justice will have the last word of this year, next year, and every age to come. So, what we're going to do is we're going to bounce around this room today. Abbott is going to give us some instructions in just a little bit. When are you doing that? Is that now? After the song. Thank you. And now to introduce this song, though. Forrest, you want to tell us about this song? Forrest, please tell us about this song. Thank you very much. You see, I encourage you all to be a defiant people, but I'm talking about being defiant to the powers of the world that want to put down human life, okay? Not to be defiant to me. All right.
This song was written not to be great musical literature, as some of my choir members say, we're singing a stupid song today. And I said, yes, did you think I thought it wasn't? So this is just a song that came to me because we're decorating the church and we might want to think about what could happen. And I thank the choir for being willing to do such a thing in front of people.
Thank you.
Decorate the church.
just perfect. And don't worry, I'm almost positive that we can have that window replaced by Christmas Eve.
Advent decorating a little bit differently this year, and instead of waiting until after the service to do it, we're going to do it right now. Yes, lock the doors, no one escape. And the reason for this is twofold. Number one is, just frankly, we think we might get it done a little faster if everyone helps, but also there's kind of the idea of real community Advent decorating, and we like spending time with our Shadow Rock family, so here is a great time to spend some time together. The theme and vision for this year's Advent decorating is, literally anything you do will be better than the plan that we have. And that is to say we don't have a plan. Not really. We have, I've made a list here in the bulletin for you. These are the areas that need some decoration. We are giving you the free rein and creativity to decorate it as you see fit. There is no right way to set up the nativity. There is no right way to put the ornaments on the tree. There is no right way to hang the greenery. So if it is something that you want to do, go with God and you do it. Because literally anything you do will be better than the plan that we have. So really quick here on the list, just so I can kind of point and explain where things are. It says we've got hang greenery, other decorations on the banisters. These are the two banisters here, and there's a couple boxes of greenery. Decorate the tree closest to the elevator. That's the short tree over here in this corner, and there's a box of ornaments and garland and ornament hooks. Go to town. Wipe out the hurricane lamps. Actually, Bill Peterson did that yesterday, so check. Thank you, Bill. Set candles in the hurricane lamps and iron holders that are in the windows. The candles are in a box right by the usher's table. Decorating the modesty rails in front of the choir. If you can be careful, they do tip over easily, so they're kind of hard to do. So just be careful doing those. Decorating the communion table. We've got greenery, we've got cloth, we've got a nativity set, whatever you want to put on there. Choosing the placement of the two nativity sets. So we've got the communion table, we can put one here. There's the round horseshoe table in the narthex. We can put one under the chrismom tree. We can put them wherever you like. But there's two full sets. And then just adding finishing touches. There's a couple boxes in the back with faint poinsettias and bows and ribbons. Anything you see that needs a little sprucing up, because anything you do is better than the plan that we have. And then there's two decorations that we'd like everyone to help with. The first is the chrismom tree, and thank you to Karen Richter. She took the time this week and made this very handy little thing in your bulletin explaining exactly what is a chrismom and why we have them. These are beautiful ornaments that are going on the big tree here in the narthex. You can either, we want everyone to hang one, so either do it now during decorating time or as you leave the sanctuary at the end of the service. Either would be fine. And there's also, we're making a ribbon banner this year. And so there's a table here with lots of ribbons. We would like everyone to choose a ribbon that speaks to you, I guess. Some are plaid, some are sparkly, some are velvety, some are green, some are red. There's lots of different ribbons. And then we're just stapling them to the banner that's there. So it'll be kind of a real community project. And again, you can do that now or you can do that as you're leaving. If you do not feel like you would like to get up and decorate with us, that is also okay. The band is going to play some music. You can use this time to just enjoy the music. You can visit with each other. This is really about community and being together as a family and making our place look beautiful. So I'll be in the back if you have questions, but just remember that literally anything you do is better than the plan that we have.
Thank you.
encourage us to celebrate our great decorating time. So I want to share with you that Abith is kind of right in that about the plan. We're trying to figure things out as we go along here, very much so. And so that one of the things that came through our visioning process actually is the idea that let's not just talk about community. We understand that people are hungry, are starving for a sense of belonging and a family and deep roots, especially spiritual roots, feeling like they belong somewhere. And so rather than just talk about it, which, you know, I could talk about it for a long time, right? You know that. But rather than talk about it, what are the things we can do so that people could experience it? So I had one person actually come up and say, you know what? This decorating is actually one of the things I do well. And so good for them. This was a gift and was a good experience for them. And we hope that they were blessed by being a part of it. So here we are, not just talking about it, not looking for sign-up sheets, not going about it in the usual way, because the usual ways just aren't working anymore. We found a new way, and we're going to constantly be experimenting. I hope you experience community. I invite you to stand if you're comfortably able, and let's sing Deck the Halls as a way of celebrating that we deck the halls. All right.
Celebration of life in this place and beyond shall now be received. Let us pray together.
Spirit of life and love, we have prepared our space for the season and for the coming of Christ. We offer our gifts to you. Infuse your spirits within them and bless us this season as we seek as a lit cup of hope and love.
Thank you.
I ask that you stand if you are comfortably able, and please join me in the dedication of ourselves and our offerings. It is also our words for mission. As we depart one from another, let our hearts be secure through every human season. Let our hearts be secure in this complex reality. Green reefs in the midst of winter. Lights in the midst of darkness. Strength of love in the vulnerability of a baby. Grace in a world of stingy gifts. Generous hearts and spirits in the midst of fear and the lie of scarcity. In the wonder and paradox of the coming season, let our hearts be secure. These are the times.
We are the people.
All of creation is blessed.
May we love all and serve all.
May God be with you.
And also with you.
Amen.